welcome everyone to our second Friday forum for UC Santa Cruz. I'm excited to welcome you all here. My name is Sherry Main. I'm the Assistant Vice Chancellor for Communications and Marketing in University Relations at the University. Before we get started, I wanted to give a couple announcements from UC Santa Cruz, and then I'll introduce our speakers for the day. We're excited to introduce and welcome a new Campus Provost Executive Vice Chancellor, Marlene Tromp. She will be joining the campus on June 1st, joining us from Arizona State University and U College, and so we're looking forward to introducing her at the next Friday Forum, or at a future Friday Forum when she is in town. I also wanted to share that we're experiencing a record number of undergraduate applications, and as we enter admission season in March and April, we're looking forward to welcoming a new cohort of students coming in. We have some exciting events coming up. This weekend, we're hosting the 4th Annual Climate and Policy Conference, which is free and open to the public. This year, we will the conference concludes with Fred Keeley Lecture in Environmental Policy. Fred will lead a panel with two of our faculty members and two alumni, Ken Alex, who is a policy advisor to Governor Brown, and a name that's familiar to many of you, John Laird, Natural Resources Secretary for California. On March 8th, we will have our second annual Giving Day. It's a 24-hour fundraising event for our campus. Last year was our first annual, with a record which helped us reach a record number of donors. March 11th is the Seymour Center Global Oceans Gala fundraiser, which will honor our former Congressman Sam Farr. He has been a true champion for our ocean and coastline, as well as the university. Shannon Watts, founder of Moms Demand Action, part of the Every Town for Gun Safety Network, will join us on March 23rd at a benefit for the Gabe Zimmerman Award Fund. Gabe was a UC Santa Cruz alum who was an aide to Congresswoman Gabby Giffords and was killed in the line of duty in the Arizona shooting. The scholarship in his name supports students with a passion for service. And the last event that I wanted to share is Alumni Weekend, which is coming up April 28th through the 30th. We're excited to share that alumna Carmen Perez, one of the four organizers of the Women's March in Washington, D.C. last month, will be our keynote speaker on Friday evening. A little bit about our program today. We have, for several years running, been one of the top universities for research influence. I think this is a measure of leading edge thinking that transforms disciplines. You know, we're known for pioneering out of the box thinking, and many of our signature achievements involves engineering, namely bioinformatics, computer game design, computational media. Today we're highlighting the Baskin School of Engineering, which is celebrating its 20th anniversary this year, and the Treehouse Childhood Cancer Initiative, which is part of the UC Santa Cruz Genomics Institute. We're excited about the growth of the Institute and our work in the pediatric cancer research area. We hold deep gratitude for Bud and Rebecca Colligan, who are here with us today, and for their support of their work. Their endowment of the Colligan Presidential Chair in Pediatric Genomics will help us extend all of this work. And so, thank you. I'd like to introduce our Dean of Engineering, Alex Wolf. Alex joined UC Santa Cruz last July. We're delighted to have Alex and his wife, Rachel, in our community. Alex comes to us from Imperial College of London, where he was a chaired professor in computing. Prior to that, he held the Charles Victor Schelk Chair in the College of Engineering and Applied Science at the University of Colorado Boulder. He was president, among other leadership roles, at the Association of Computing Machinery and chaired the Special Interest Group in Software Engineering. Alex earned a BA in Computer Science and Geology at Queens College City, University of New York, and a master's and PhD degree in Computer Science at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. He spent 5 years as a member of the technical staff of AT&T Bell Laboratories in New Jersey. Alex is already leading us into the future, including the development of our research facilities on Delaware Avenue and on the west side near our coastal campus. So, Alex.
Thank you, Sherry. It's really a pleasure to be able to spend a few minutes with you and tell you a little bit about why I'm here, why I came, what's exciting me about the School of Engineering, and of course to introduce our wonderful speaker. A number of people asked me why I came, why Rachel and I moved from London and came here. Obviously, it's beautiful. Obviously, we're trying to get away from the rain. sort of, tried, didn't succeed. People tell me this is unusual, and I can only believe them, so we'll see. But no, the real reason is that the engineering school here is really uniquely positioned for 21st century engineering, and engineering that is solving real world problems. Interesting for me, being at Imperial College, Imperial was created out of a surplus that came from the Great Exposition in 1851. So the Great Exposition actually. Not an expedition, an exhibition. This exhibition, of course, was a way of introducing engineering to the UK, and Prince Albert decided to have this big event with the Crystal Palace in Hyde Park. And this thing ran a surplus, and with the surplus, he was able to create a college that was dedicated to engineering and science, and the intersection of engineering and science. And interestingly, what happened after that was a medical school was added. So this institution, which combined science and engineering and medicine, was an experience for me that I think was quite transformative. And I think that's part of what's appealing here in Santa Cruz. We don't have a medical school, and David likes to tell me about why that's a big advantage, and I think he's really, really convinced me about that. And I'll say more about that in a minute. So this engineering school we have, as I said, is really shaped for the 21st century. And what I've been saying to people is that it's not 19th century engineering. And if I think about the 1851 exhibition and what that led to at Imperial College, it led to very traditional 19th century engineering, mechanical engineering and civil engineering and chemical engineering, where BSOE came from was really the world of the internet, and it's 20 years old, and it, as we like to say, it grew up and is growing up with the internet age. So our focus really is in things around computation, around the intersection of engineering and medicine, life, health, and these sorts of societal issues that are really underlie Santa Cruz and what Santa Cruz stands for. Santa Cruz the community and Santa Cruz the university. So for me, this was a very appealing place to work, to lead, and to live. So we are growing incredibly. Obviously, this is creating some interesting tensions within the university, within Santa Cruz. Engineering is exploding. This academic year, engineering grew 35% in undergraduate population year over year. It grew 60% year over year in graduate population. So we are really, really exploding. And we currently have about 22% of the undergraduates, about 32% of the graduate students on campus. And those numbers are just continuing to grow. And so Sherry mentioned we have a record number of undergraduate applications. So many of these students are interested in getting involved in engineering. And these are students who obviously have opportunities in many places. But what Santa Cruz offers, again, is this opportunity to impact society, to do social good, to work on problems around sustainability, health, life, and really the betterment of society And I think that's really important and distinguishing for us. Now, the graduates, of course, have had a big impact on our local community here. One of the interesting facts about Santa Cruz graduates is that they tend to cluster around here. I was told, okay, as dean, you're going to have to go out and you're going to have to visit the graduates. And if you talk to other deans around the country, they spend their time flying around the country. And we don't really have to do that because our graduates tend to stay in Santa Cruz, stay in the Bay Area, stay somewhere around here because there's, again, so much opportunity in this area. And they see the benefit of being here and growing their ideas in the local community. So we have a number of distinguished alumni who've been doing that. I think you might be aware of Sarah Eisenberg, who's one of our graduates. She is the person behind Santa Cruz Tech Beat, a great friend of the engineering school. Doug Erickson, who has created the Tech Meetup, which I had the pleasure of attending. It's an incredibly exciting place. You know, 300 or so tech entrepreneurs all getting together to share their experiences and talk about how to bring real innovation and economic development to Santa Cruz and the Santa Cruz area. Our alumni are also part of just the local tech scene as employees, of course. Plantronics, Looker, these are just some of the companies that we have graduates working in. There are many other companies that are around here and coming, and we're populating a lot of those companies. And of course, the Genomics Institute has led to a number of spin-outs, very important spin-outs, developing a kind of economy around these genomic technologies and developing pretty much on the west side. It's becoming really a nexus of that kind of technology, and there's that tipping point, I think, in a work economy where you get enough energy in an area and things start spontaneously happening, and I think that's happening here. And so just to name some of these companies, Dovetail, Antomics, 5-3 Genomics, and two poor guys, we recently featured an article on them on our website, and they're just going gangbusters with their technologies. So let me just say a few words about genomics. It's
nanopore.
Yeah, nanopore. Sorry. Nanopore, yeah, to P-O-R-E. I'm sorry, it's P-O-R-E, guys, not, yeah. They are, and you know, maybe they're currently poor, but we hope that they won't be poor for long. So,
abbreviation is
2PG. 2PG, okay, 2PG, all right. Even less accessible. So the Genomics Institute is clearly one of the jewels. I guess if I was in England, I would say crown jewels. But it's one of the jewels of Santa Cruz, and David has obviously been the force behind the creation and advancement of this. And it was really, of course, one of the founders of the entire intellectual discipline, and you know, it's just an incredible opportunity for us, incredible honor for us, and advantage for us to have David here as part of our community and as part of the university and part of the School of Engineering. And what this institute really represents is something which is aligned very well with the ethos of Santa Cruz. So it's about being collaborative and open, and as you know, BSOE is where the human genome was first sequenced, and very importantly, it was the place where it was made public. And it was a competition with a company that was, of course, interested in not sharing this information. And David, in a remarkable feat of technology with his cohort and his vision of sharing information, sharing data, and understanding that that would lead to greater solutions, greater opportunities for solutions to disease, but also lead to a development of an industry around genomics by being open. And that publication of the human genome, first sequencing of the human genome, was an extremely important landmark event in the world, literally, and it happened here in Santa Cruz. So we're very excited about where the Genomics Institute is going and its growth. It is growing, and you know, we're doing our part in engineering to foster that growth. And David and I are working together to make sure that we're all positioned and aligned to see it succeed in the future. And in fact, we're having lunch later today to talk about that. I don't know. Rachel's not going to be happy about this. So that brings me to Olena. Olena Morozova is one of the prime examples of the kind of person that is attracted to the Genomics Institute and to the mission of the Genomics Institute. And she is a very special person in our world up on the hill there. Olena is a postdoctoral scholar. She is leading the Treehouse Cancer Initiative. And this is, as you know, an effort to defeat childhood cancer through genomic research and sharing, in particular, of genomic data. She was also selected to be the scientific lead for California Kids Cancer Comparison. This is a California initiative to advance precision medicine, and this was recently launched by Governor Brown. And so it's a real tribute to Olena and to the Genomics Institute. She really brings a passion and a personal drive to this enterprise and to helping create lives and save young lives. So please welcome Olena Morozova.
Thank you very much for that generous introduction. It's my honor today to talk to you about our work with the Treehouse Childhood Cancer Initiative. And just brief background to the field. Unfortunately, kids do get cancer as well as adults. And in the United States, we have about 42 children diagnosed with cancer every day. So that comes out to be about 1 in 300 boys or girls will get cancer by the time they turn 20. So it's not as rare as we may think, and actually cancer is the number one cause of death by disease in the United States. So even though both children and adults get cancer, these cancers are very different, actually. The adult cancers is something we understand perhaps better why they happen, and they usually happen, or we think they happen, because of a combination of a degree of genetic predisposition and also exposure to environmental factors such as smoking or bad diet or viruses and so on. And so as we age, our risk of getting cancer goes up. And so actually, if all of us live long enough, we're all gonna get cancer at some point because of these exposures to life, really. However, childhood cancers are very different from this. Sometimes kids are born with cancer. They get these cancers very early. And so this kind of idea of environmental exposure or smoking as a cause of cancer doesn't work there. And so there is something else. And so we actually think of childhood cancers as disorders of normal development or failure of the body to develop normally and developing an abnormal tumor. And because of this idea that this is a disorder of normal development, incidence of pediatric cancer, childhood cancer, actually goes down with age. So as we age, we have less risk of developing a pediatric type of cancer, but we have a higher risk of developing an adult cancer. So if you accept this idea that cancers are caused by DNA damage, and DNA damage is really DNA mutations. I will explain what they are, but for this slide, so DNA damage due to environment equals DNA mutations. And so adult cancers, so based on what I said before, you might expect that adult cancers will have more DNA damage, more mutations, because these are older people that get those diseases. Whereas childhood cancers will not have that much damage in the form of mutations. And so so at the level of the DNA or at the level of the genome, these are different diseases. What's also true is that despite being simpler and having less damage, less mutations, childhood cancers are actually much more aggressive than adult cancers and are treated much more aggressively. So current treatment paradigms are actually very, very devastating for kids with cancer. Sometimes it's multiple years of treatment, and it's aggressive chemotherapy, radiation therapy, bone marrow transplant. And the idea is that we try to really throw everything at these kids and hope to kill the tumor before killing the child. And so because we treat these diseases so aggressively, once a cancer is back after that treatment, it usually comes back with a vengeance, and it's usually incurable. So the devastating facts we have in the field of pediatric cancer is that, like I said, once a tumor comes back, once a patient recurs, the tumor is usually incurable. And also some of the diagnoses, like diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma, or DIPG, is incurable right at the start. So actually, we have some diseases in the pediatric cancer population that don't respond to anything. They don't even respond to aggressive chemotherapies or radiation. And so in California alone, we have about 400 to 500 children a year that fall into one of those two categories. Either their tumor comes back from treatment, or they have a tumor like DIPG that doesn't respond to treatment. And so those children are out of treatment options. Today, we don't have anything that we could do for them. And nationwide, that number is about 2,500. So in California, we have about 12% of the nationwide pediatric cancer cases. So what can we do about this? Can genomics help us find more treatments, better treatments for children with cancer? And you've heard that at our institute at UC Santa Cruz, we have a history of this genomic work going back to the Human Genome Project, which David's team published on the internet, and they were the first group to do this. So we've been thinking about genomics a lot and have been applying genomics to the study. I'm sorry. Sorry. Oh, my God.
All right.
Yeah, I'm really sorry.
No.
You're a busy person, Lynn.
Well, it's good because it was all very gloomy to this.
Now we have some humor.
So how can genomics apply to cancer? And this is this idea of DNA damage or mutations that it talked about previously. So if you think of DNA, every cell in our body has DNA, and we were born with the same DNA in every cell, and we call that the genome. So the collective component of the DNA, or content of the DNA in every cell, is called the genome. And so this genome, which is written in the letters A, C, T, G, so it's really just the alphabet of four letters, so this determines, or this provides instructions for how our cells and our whole body functions. And as we go through life, and as we're exposed to different things, different foods, different environmental exposures, so this DNA can mutate, and it's basically shown here. So this is really, you can think of it as a spelling mistake. Letters can change into other letters. And as we go through life, this happens more and more. And so eventually, we accumulate enough of these spelling mistakes, then the instructions change completely, and so then the cells become different from what they originally were meant to be, and this is what cancer is. It's really uncontrolled cell growth and cells becoming abnormal and just growing on their own. So this is really the cancer genomic paradigm, and in the last few years, we have seen a sequencing revolution where we now have the technologies to read these letters, so to read those genomes and understand what these spelling mistakes are. And so the idea is once we understand these spelling mistakes, maybe we can develop a therapy that can kill a cell that has that DNA mutation or has that spelling mistake. And so this is the cancer genomics paradigm. But what I have told you before is that pediatric cancers actually don't have that many spelling mistakes because they're not exposed to so much damage as adult cancers are. And so if you look at the pediatric cancer genomes, you may not be able to find that many mistakes. And so while this paradigm is great for adults, it doesn't really work for kids, or it doesn't work for most kids. And this is where the drug development is, because in the adults, this is such a concept that we understand very well, and I hope this model makes sense to you, that if we can find these spelling mistakes, we can make a drug, and then we can apply that drug to a patient. So this is something we understand, something we can do. Doesn't work for kids, unfortunately. So what can we do for kids, and what can we do specifically in Santa Cruz? Well, you all know we don't have a medical center. All we have is a genomics team and a lot of bioinformaticians. So I'd like to share with you how we got into this in the first place. So as every medical story, perhaps this started from one patient, a little boy named Kelvin. So Kelvin was an 8-year-old boy and had a very rare form of sarcoma. In fact, they couldn't diagnose the type of sarcoma that he had. And Kelvin was treated at British Columbia Children's Hospital in Vancouver, in British Columbia. And so his sarcoma was profiled by DNA sequencing. So the DNA of his tumor cells was read to look for these mutations. But also the RNA was read, and I will explain what that means. So these data were collected, and so the analysis that was done identified one mutation in him. So we did find, or our colleagues in Vancouver did find a mutation, but the problem was that this mutation was different from what we see in adults. And so there was no drugs, because all the drug development focuses around adult mutations because they're common and we understand them much better. But in this case, so this genomic analysis was done, but for him, there was no treatment that could be suggested based on this analysis. And so it's back to square one. Even though this technology was applied, nothing we could do. And so we in Santa Cruz were privileged to get access to these data, and we were able to analyze it. And specifically, we analyzed the RNA data, and I will explain what that means and how that's different. And our analysis actually suggested some directions to consider by his team, and so actually resulted in clinical success and extended his life for 2 years. Unfortunately, Kelvin did pass away from his disease. But one thing that really touches me deeply and touches all of us is that one of Kelvin's dying wishes was actually for us to use his name, Kelvin, which is what I'm doing today. So he knew he was involved in this new research. He was very excited about it. He wanted to help and he wanted to contribute, and he wanted us to use his name. So what is RNA and why it matters? Why do we need to look at the RNA? So this is an analogy I have. So if you think of a cookbook which has instructions for how to make many different meals, and it has a lot of different recipes, but at any given time, you may only use one recipe or a couple of recipes to make something. And so the analogy here is that a cookbook is our DNA. So DNA in each cell has instructions for many different things, but then at any given time, you only use some of those instructions. You don't cook everything at once. And so RNA is the instructions, the recipe that you use at any given time. And then that recipe makes the product protein, which actually does its function in the cell. And so the idea is that for cancer, you can have an error at the level of the DNA or a spelling mistake in the book, but you can also have an error. So you might think that another way that your cell can be abnormal is if you have an abnormal amount of the RNA or abnormal recipe that you use at any given time. So for example, you have vegetarian friends coming for dinner and you happen to cook a meat dish for them. And so that's a mistake. And so our view on pediatric cancer is, what if we looked at the RNA? What if we, in addition to looking at the DNA and the spelling mistakes, what if we also consider the amount of these products that are being used in every cell? And so here is a diagram. Kind of the current paradigm of cancer genomic analysis is to look at the DNA from the tumor and then look at the DNA from the blood, which represents the DNA we were born with, so the original sequence, and the tumor is the changed sequence in the cancer, and look for a mutation. And so to that, we're adding this RNA analyte that will tell us which genes are turned on in the tumor and whether the genes that are turned on are abnormal or there is too much or too little of something. And so just to illustrate how that was used in Kelvin's case, here I'm showing you the amount of a gene called ALK, A-L-K. And the significance of ALK is that there is a drug in adult cancer, so developed for lung cancer, that can target this, can target this protein and can kill cells that have that protein. And so here on the y-axis, we're looking at the amount of this ALK, so not DNA mutation, but just the amount, how much of ALK you have. And you can see these two bars are tumors, so these are lung tumors, and these are pediatric neuroblastoma tumors that respond to ALK inhibitor called crizotinib. And this is Kelvin's tumor, and so you can see visually that this is similar to this and that, and different from sarcomas, which are other tumors that in name are sarcoma. So Kelvin had a sarcoma as well. And so you can see how by looking at this RNA, you can have this extra information that even though there is no mutation in ALG, but the amount of this is abnormal. And in fact, it's similar to what we see in tumors that respond to this drug. So because of Kelvin, we were very excited and we were very honored that this analysis could actually help somebody in the clinic. And so we wanted to see whether this was a one-off anecdotal example or whether this can actually help other kids. And so we asked the question, does this comparative RNA analysis, so finding genes like ALK, that expression is abnormal and similar to something else that has a drug, whether this analysis can actually produce, can help identify new treatment options for kids that are out of treatment options otherwise. And the rationale for this and why we really focus on comparative and comparing to adult cancers is that most drug development does happen in adults, and we can't change that. We're not developing new drugs in Santa Cruz. That's not our expertise. But what we can help with is we can identify situations like that ALK, where a rare tumor is similar enough to some adult tumor where there is a drug, and that we can reposition that drug to that patient based on this additional information. And our approach is to compare each child to other cancer patients, adult and pediatric, basically as many cancer patients as we can get our hands on and come up with these predictions. And of course, comparing the RNA space, because as I mentioned, if you look at the DNA space, we often don't find anything because most of these children will not have many mutations to look at. And so what we're doing is we're really using big data to help children whose tumors don't have adult cancer mutations. And so just to summarize what I've said is children are not little adults. The tumors in children are different. We need to look beyond mutations, and we specifically look at the RNA, and we look at this RNA sequencing-derived gene expression information, and we utilize data from multiple cancer patients, both adult and pediatric, and we're looking for relative measurements, and that's why we need more data. So just briefly, I will show you some of the tools we have for this. This is our tool developed by Professor Josh Stewart at UCSC called Tumor Map. And so this is to illustrate the power of comparisons. Here, every dot represents a tumor from a cancer patient. And in this particular map, we have over 10,000 dots, over 10,000 cancer patients profiled by this approach. And you can see they're laid out in this space by how similar the tumors are in this RNA space, so not the DNA, but the RNA space, and then colored by the type of cancer. And so you can see breast cancers are here, neuroblastomas are here. But then you also see clusters of multiple colored dots. And so what it's saying, even though there is a sarcoma, but it actually, at the level of RNA, is similar to some other tumor, and which is could be very meaningful to treatment. And just this approach is illustrated here, is that you have lung cancers here in yellow, bladder cancer in blue, but then you might have a lung cancer that is at the level of RNA similar to a bladder cancer, and then perhaps it should be treated like a bladder cancer. Basically, this is the idea. So we are growing. We have a lot of partners, including Jacob's Heart, and thank you, Lori, for supporting us throughout. And we have partnered with, I think, 9 now different hospitals that... So because, as I said, we're not a medical center ourselves, and we're not trying to be, but what we're trying to do is we're trying to provide this additional information to hospitals that are treating patients, and so we're partnering with everybody who will partner with us, and we're looking for more. So to date, the number of patients we have, so we have presented 33 cases like Kelvin's, and we have discussed these cases in a tumor board setting. And so what tumor board is a meeting like this, really, that has a lot of oncologists and radiation specialists and now bioinformaticians that discuss each difficult case and then discuss what to do for that child. And so we have presented 33 patients in this type of tumor board setting. We have identified new information in 100% of cases, so which means we have identified some potential options for a patient. So it doesn't mean we have found cures for 100%. I mean, that would be amazing. But we have found something to consider for 100% of the patients that we have analyzed, and that compares to less than 50% if you just look at the DNA mutation. So what we often see with DNA mutation analysis is that clinicians come back and say there is nothing that mutation suggests, so there is nothing we can do. What we are saying, there is more we can consider, at least by incorporating this other information. We know of 4 known clinical actions, which means somebody actually went and tried that drug in the clinic, and so far we know of 2 confirmed clinical responses, and we only started doing this in May of this year. So we're very excited, and of course, we want to do more. So just briefly, I know I'm probably way over time, but I just want to show you one recent case that was analyzed in this way, and this is a little boy with hepatoblastoma, a rare liver cancer. So a commercial DNA sequencing analysis test called Foundation Medicine, so this is a company that looks for DNA mutations in tumors, found that this tumor had a mutation. But again, like in Kelvin's case, there is this mutation, but there is no drug today that can target this mutation. And so for this patient, it's meaningless that we know this. It's interesting from biology point of view, but it's not clinically relevant. And so our analysis found that this pediatric hepatoblastoma was similar to an adult liver cancer. And I'm not going to go into detail, but I'm happy to talk about the details if somebody asks me later. But so long story short, we found that this tumor had features of a particular type of liver cancer. And based on that, we could identify 4 different therapeutic directions to consider by this tumor board team, by the clinical team. And so all of these drugs, or 3 of these drugs, are FDA approved already for some other indication, including one which is a diabetes drug, actually metformin approved for diabetes. And then there was also a clinical trial that we identified that this patient could go on. And so for this patient in May of this year, we recommended 4 therapeutic directions that I mentioned on the previous slide to consider. then clinician chose one of the directions, a drug called pazopanib, and then the disease for this child was kept at bay for a couple of months, but then progressed. And then clinician switched to our next prediction, which was ruxolitinib. And now what we know is that the family moved to Oregon for their personal reasons, but that the child is doing well, and they're sending pictures of this child doing quite well. And then in January, we actually reanalyzed this case, because as we get more data, we usually go back and reanalyze to see if we can learn additional information. And so that analysis strengthened our consideration for metformin, which is a diabetes drug. And we know now that the clinician is actually considering adding that on top of the ruxolitinib, because this is not a very toxic medication, so it might be possible to add that in combination to improve the robustness of this effect. And so we're very excited about this. And just to point out that the clinicians don't just go and try something we predict, so they often do validation tests. Like in this case, the clinician did do some clinically approved testing to actually verify that these are good directions. So what we do is we provide information, and then the clinical team can follow up on this. So we're very excited, and we are very excited and want to do more. And we have a really great team now. I would really like to thank all of the team members, many of whom are here, and my advisor, David Hausler, for his leadership, and Isabel Bjork, who is our program director, and she actually was the one who took this from an idea and turned this into an operation, and I'm really, really grateful to you and to all of you. And just one thing, I have been really kind of overwhelmed by this community, because I think we could really only pull this off in Santa Cruz. And thank you, all of you, your passion and generosity and commitment to this cause.
I think if we have questions for Olena, we have some time.
Great, it was so interesting, Olena. Thank you so much. I was interested because you were focusing mostly on drugs as the solution. Mm-hmm. Replicate. I've heard a little bit about that. I wonder what's happening in that area.
So that's a thank you for asking that question. So David Hausler also has a wet lab up on the hill that actually does do CRISPR technology. And actually, one of these mutations, so that's something I was also involved in earlier. We actually do have this research project going on where we identify some of these mutations that are not currently druggable. So the mutation, for example, I showed the beta-catenin mutation, that there is no drug, but you know, maybe later somebody could develop a drug. And so we're using CRISPR to put that mutation into stem cells and then create a model of these pediatric cancers that we can then use for drug development. So this is something else that's going on. The point of Treehouse is really translational and what's immediately clinically useful. So that's kind of our goal with this project. But all of these other studies, the CRISPR is definitely complementary, and we definitely need to do that to advance the field. It's just our focus right now is to see what we can do to help children in the clinic today.
Olena is being too modest giving me any kind of credit for this. Olena made the first CRISPR line, cell line, for one of these key mutations. So she does wet lab work as well.
A question on the partners. You said there's 9 going to 11. Are those partners all agreeing to give you all of their data? And where is this data going? And how big is the data set now that you're drawing from to help solve these cases?
That's a very good question. So we're trying our best to, so we do have to enter into data sharing agreements with the partners, and we're doing this on case by case, so with each partner individually. We're trying, and Isabel and our legal office are working very hard to make sure that the agreements we enter in don't restrict us, you know, allow us to release as much data as possible. But of course, we can't really control because it's not our patients. So we try our best to make sure that when we sign something, we are able to then release the data, because of course our dream is to be able to just release the data into the public setting. Unfortunately, I can't say that we can do that right now. We're trying our best to do as much of that as possible.
Yeah. If you want to say something else.
I mean, the problem is that we, because we're focusing on the translational piece, you know, we want to help kids that are in the clinic right now, we take what we can get, right, from our partners. And so sometimes they restrict sharing. More and more, though, recently, our agreements are allowing us to put out into the public the results of our analysis. And so that ends up being helpful for researchers everywhere. And so what we're trying to do is kind of figure out the middle ground, right? So some partners don't want to share their data directly, but they will allow us to provide out information that can be helpful to other researchers. So it's a, you know, it's an evolving field, and it's really important from a policy direction that we talk about it as much as possible and get that information out there so that there's some pressure on all sorts of organizations to share for the benefit of all rather than all research teams.
I had just quickly to add that before you jump in, Alex. I had a great conversation actually 2 days ago in San Francisco with the director of Helen Diller Cancer Comprehensive Cancer Center at UCSF, and he's very supportive of this. And so they will move towards more immediate sharing of the data, again, because they see how much it would help these efforts to compare all cases around the world. So the wheels are in motion there, and the reason I was late here is I was on an international call, so we have contact with countries all over the world who are trying to also promote data sharing.
I was just curious if this concern about data sharing by the organizations is driven by commercial considerations or privacy considerations?
I think there is a lot of, it's a complicated question. I think it's a bit of both. Also, fear of the unknown. I think, you know, people have watched movies like Gattaca, and they think that if, you know, you share that information, it's going to be devastating. And I think there is a lot of, I think on our part, we also have to do a better job of explaining what this means and what are the risks and what it really means as scientists. But definitely there is privacy considerations. There is commercial considerations. If you ask patients, or if you ask families of kids with cancer, which we actually have, they all want to share, and they want to share immediately, and they really want to help the next family after them. So sometimes it's actually very interesting. We're thinking we're protecting them, but actually if we ask them, they want to share. And so we're trying to communicate that.
Again, I'll be a little more blunt on this. This is a social movement. It has to be a social movement. It has to come from you. I've been on a dismal call with the University of California Office of the President discussion about the medical records from the UC system. 14 million records. 90% of the call is, how can we monetize this? What pharmaceutical companies can we sell this data to help support our efforts? Very little discussion of sharing. So, yeah, it's about privacy, but it's more about money. I'll just be blunt.
Can I make a comment? We've talked about this a lot. This really needs to come from the groundswell of movement from the parents themselves. And it is almost without exception that every parent, especially parents who lose a child, really want that their child's data to make a difference for others. It is just a human need. And if we're talking about working with the parent community to really empower people about how to ask the questions, how to know what it is, how to communicate with their physicians so that we can get the movement that way. So I just think it's those kinds of motivations run counter to what the families who are experiencing this
exactly
have. so that we need to put that into this big box of how we can do it.
And ultimately, these families have a right to that data.
Yes.
They can ask for it, and they can share it themselves if the authorities are unwilling to do that.
And it takes a long time for a parent, when they ask, to get it, as we've experienced, and it's very frustrating.
So in terms of data sets and stuff, are you guys doing anything with the NIH's Precision Medical Initiative to capture basically records for a million people? I assume that's going to be shareable or redacted in some way?
So we have a lot of the NCI data in our tumor map that I showed already. So that's the data from the Cancer Genome Atlas project and the target, which is a pediatric counterpart. So we have in total, just to your question, about 11,000 cancer patients right now that we're comparing each child to. And the bulk of that is actually the NIH data. And we have a relationship with the Genomic Data Commons in Chicago, which is now the repository for all of that data to get as much as possible. There is a delay in how that becomes available, so it's not in real time. Unfortunately, we would like to get it as soon as it's generated, but unfortunately there is a delay. But we're working very hard to grow that and to release that to the public as much as possible.
So how do you form these partnerships with hospitals and other organizations around you in order to just do what you guys are doing?
So, well, just try to meet people and talk to them and at conferences. Just meeting people.
It's organic. I mean, you know, we sought out hospitals, and now there are enough talks and enough information out there that people are starting to come to us as well, which is amazing.
And the California Initiative to Advance Precision Medicine that Alex mentioned, yes. So that helped us a lot as well in California. So we started with three partners in California and plus the Vancouver partner that Kelvin's case was at, and then we grew from there.
Let me say one thing more quickly about the Precision Medicine Initiative. The Precision Medicine Initiative, as you know, is aimed at a million people. It will probably start recruiting now, and we may get up to a million in about 5 years, 10 years from now. So it's a slow ramp. We are involved in it. However, of those million cases, there will be very few rare pediatric cancers. Because you just can't say, okay, we're going to take a sample of a million and we're going to find the rare ones. The only way you're going to get the rare pediatric cancers that Olena needs is to have every rare case, when it comes up, participate in it. So it's completely the wrong design for rare pediatric cancers.
So just a thought and then a specific question after that. Yes, families are a role player. Hospitals have been in healthcare for quite a while, and the providers tend to be more anti-sharing. It's part of their DNA, if you will. Payers are another critical role player in the industry, and they will have a very different business orientation. So if you went to a medical director of some mm-hmm. of the payers, and I'm talking about both the insurers, but then also groups like the Pacific Business Group on Health up in San Francisco, they have been very fundamental in building sharing, not administrative data, some medical data. And I would think that they would be interested in getting better treatments, more effective, cost-effective treatments for their patients. They might be key players. And one player like that, of course, is Kaiser Permanente, mm-hmm. who probably don't have too much treatment of pediatric cancers themselves, but certainly have the peer role. So my specific question is, given that they have 20-25% of the state's population covered, have you gone to them, some of their medical directors, to look for support?
We had a very good meeting with Kaiser. We sat down with them, a breakfast much like this, but intimate with their leaders who were initiating a project for a tumor repository within Kaiser. So we felt they would be the best people to talk to. And some of our local physicians helped, actually, Dr. DiGataldi. The meeting went well. We thought it went well. But then somebody in Kaiser somewhere decided that, well, maybe we could make some money off this tumor repository. And the conversation ended.
Became a competitor.
I'm sorry, I'm just being very blunt. That's how it went. Now maybe we could reconvince it. Maybe, you know, maybe if we all got together and spoke a little louder. But as payers, I think it was a stupid idea, frankly. You're absolutely right. It's in the payer's interest to not be short-sighted about this, but to actually think about if they shared the data, how things would go better, and they would have to pay less for medical treatment, because it would be better.
Just, Kaiser is a monster with many heads.
Yes, so right. We probably were talking to the right head.
Because yeah. they are, in the other sense, leaders in initiatives to change things. So they do have this change agent entity in one of their heads, and the other is the other head. So
maybe we went to the wrong head, David.
Yeah,
yeah,
right.
One more question. As a lay person, on the not frequent but occasional conversations that I have with people about anything having to do with research about medicine, children, genetics, people immediately, the references are all movies and science fiction reading they've done. And I always feel so limited about, you know, I need my talking points, you know, I need my elevator speech. Where's a place for lay people to get information that we can use and begin to talk about it in a more casual way with people? Because it sounds to me like that's the only way it's going to happen.
Absolutely. And I think with Treehouse, we actually have that as one of our priorities also, to communicate better and to educate people, because I do agree with Lori, this has to come from families. I mean, there is no other way. So I think from us, hopefully.
We need to clone you.
Yeah. It's so scary for people. They want to distance themselves. You
That's
know?
True.
Right. I get that. But
thank you, Olena.
Thank you.